Hey guys, welcome to yet another session by IntelliPath. In today's video, we'll be learning about a software tool called ELK or Elastic Stack. It is not a single tool, rather a set of different tools used to collect, analyze, and visualize data. But before we go ahead with that, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon so you don't miss any of our future updates. Okay, now let's take a quick glance at our agenda. So the first thing we'll learn is, what is ELK or Elastic Stack? Then we'll go ahead and understand what are the components of ELK. Since I said earlier, it is a set of rather different and unique tools. And then we will understand what is the ELK flow, how data flows from one component to another component. And then we'll see what are the features of ELK. And then finally, we'll understand how to install ELK and we'll see how to use it in various scenarios. So without any further ado, let's go ahead with the session.
What is ELK? Or Elastic Stack. Elastic Stack refers to a set of open source products that have been developed by Elastic to help its users collect data from different types of sources and then analyze the collected data and represent it in an easy to understand and aesthetic visualization. This is done so that meaningful observations can be made. What we have here is that we have a couple of multiple tools that have been developed by a company called Elastic that allows us to collect data from multiple sources and then use that data to make wonderful visualizations through which we can come up with meaningful observations about how that particular source is working. For example, if we had a code pipeline and if we wanted to see how the requests are being made into it or how well the code pipeline is functioning, we need to monitor how well it's working. So we would use the couple of tools that ELK is providing us. First, we will collect the data from the code pipeline and then we will store it in a place and then we will use that stored data and create meaningful visualizations. Whoever is managing the code pipeline can understand where the problems are coming from and how well the code pipeline is functioning. Now, this is just an example. Now, these tools can be used for multiple purposes and many places, and we will see where they will be used in the next videos. Learning how to use all the components of Elastic Stack takes some time, but the payoff is great and grants a deeper understanding of software's underlying structure. Now, understanding how to use all of these softwares combined is a little bit tough, but once you know how to use them properly, it gives a great payoff. You can have a great knowledge about how to use it. And if you have a great knowledge about how to use the software, you can make much more complicated and yet simple to understand dashboards, visualizations that will give us a clear idea of how a particular product or how a particular service is functioning. So some of the pros for using ELK are, first, it's highly scalable, and second, it does all the processing in real time. Being highly scalable means that when you want to expand a business or when you expand the limits of your service that you're providing people, you want to make sure that you're doing a good job. So you want to make sure that you're getting a perfect result. So for that, you would use a monitoring tool to see how well your service or your product is doing. So if you suppose expanded and added multiple servers for your application or for the service you're providing, you want to see how well those servers are performing. So you could use ELK for that purpose. And ELK can be used even with single server or a small application, and it can be used with multiple servers or a bigger application. And it being real-time processing means that it can be attached to an application that is working at the current time. If suppose your application is right now in production and it is being used by customers, even then ELK can be used by attaching itself to the product and then monitoring how well it is working. All the logs of how people are accessing it, from where they're accessing, what browser they're using, where they're using it from, all those details will be stored in some log file. And that log file will be given to your ELK, where it will process it and analyze it so that a good visualization could be created when the person who is responsible to see how well the app is working can figure out where he needs to put his attention more. If suppose the app is not getting a lot of attention from a particular area, then he can focus on that particular area of the world. Or if there are some issues in the app, if there's a lot of memory usage, but you do not see as many as users on your app, that means there might be some kind of security issue. So the person who's monitoring it can figure this out using this product. Now, ELK is an open source software. But even though it's open source, there's a paid version, which has some extra features. But these features aren't deal breakers. You can satisfactorily use the open source version for most of your needs.
Quick note here, guys, if you want to learn more about DevOps or become a certified DevOps engineer, IntelliPart does provide a DevOps certification course, which is taught by certified industry professionals who will teach you many different DevOps tools. And if you want to know more about it, there are links in the description below.
What are the components of Elk? Now that we have understood what Elk is, let's see which all tools are used inside Elk. Now remember, Elk is a set of tools. There are multiple tools used inside of Elk. So that is why we call it Elastic Stack. It used to be called Elk before because in the starting, when the company started, they had only one software that was Elasticsearch. And after they started to expand, they got two new softwares that was Logstash and Kibana. When they had these three tools, they made all of them together and they made it into Elk, that is Elasticsearch, Logstash and Kibana. But after that, they added one more component, one more tool called Beats. So they did not want to keep this precedent of adding more letters to their name. They decided to change it and they made it into Elastic Stack instead of Elk. Saying Elk or Elastic Stack, both are right. It depends on what you want to say. So let's see what are the components of Elk. First, it's Elasticsearch. It is used for storing and searching collected data. Second is Logstash, used for collecting and filtering the input data. Now you would use Logstash to collect all the data that you need, all the raw data, and then you would filter the raw data. And after you're done filtering the raw data, you would send it to Elasticsearch, where the filtered data will be stored and indexed. The third tool is Kibana. Kibana provides a graphical user interface. After your Logstash has collected all the data and it has filtered it according to our needs and sent it to Elasticsearch for storing and indexing, then you can use Kibana to use that data from Elasticsearch and make meaningful visualizations. You would use Kibana as your main user interface after you've installed all of these tools. And inside Kibana, you can make a dashboard according to your need. If you want a heat map of wherever your requests are coming from all over the world, or your world map or a coordinate map or a bar chart or a pie chart, etc. Any kind of visualizations you wish to. And the fourth and the final tool is Beats. Now, Beats are itself multiple lightweight data collectors. Now, Beats is just like Logstash, but it differs in the fact that it doesn't filter the data and it can much more easily collect data than Logstash since they're lightweight, small tools. Now, Logstash is one tool, but Beats have multiple small tools inside it, which can attach them to their particular source and collect data from there, which we will see further. Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is a NoSQL database that was developed based on Apache Lucene search engine. It can be used to index and store multiple different types of documents and data. It provides a function to search the data that is stored in real time as it's being fed. Elasticsearch is where all the data would be stored. It is the NoSQL database where multiple different formats of data can be stored and indexed. Logstash. Logstash is a collection agent and is used to collect both heterogeneous and non-heterogeneous data from various sources. It has the capability to screen, break down, and make string alterations in the data it collects. After it has collected and filtered the data, it then sends it to Elasticsearch for storage. What Logstash does it, as I said before, it collects the data and then it filters it and then breaks it down according to our need and then sends it to Elasticsearch so that it can be stored over there. Kibana. Kibana is a graphical user interface that is used to display the data that was collected and stored in Elasticsearch. It displays them with appealing visuals so that the data could be easily understood, analyzed. It does so using multiple different types of visuals like bar charts, pie charts, world map, heat maps, coordinate maps, etc. After Logstash has collected the data and filtered it and then sent it to Elasticsearch for storage, then, only then can Kibana take that data and create a graphical interface. And using that, the users can create visuals using the data we collected. Basically, Kibana gives us a UI during data access in Elasticsearch. So now let's see what are the features of Kibana. Since it's the main interface users will be using to access anything or control anything inside Elk. So the first feature, discover the data by exploring it. This basically means that whenever you collect data, you're exploring that data about your service or product. It means you understand your data by exploring it, by understanding how it is being produced. Second feature, analyze the data by applying different metrics. Now, Kibana allows us to analyze the data we have collected by applying different metrics. If you wanted to use a timestamp or use geolocation or use the number of days that have been spent on that particular product or see which kind of browser is being used, all those different kinds of metrics can be used. Basically, applying different filters on the raw data. Visualize the data by creating different types of charts. We can have different types of dashboards with different types of graphs and different types of charts. If you wanted to create a dashboard customized for one of your specific applications, then you can do that and then you can save that dashboard. Anytime you want to monitor how well your application is doing or the data that is coming from that application, you can use that dashboard. Apply machine learning on the data to get data anomaly. Basically, you can use machine data to study the data you're collecting. And based on your study, you can figure out if there are any anomalies in that data or not. Also, again, this is a feature of the pro version of Elk, not the open source version. Manage users and roles. Basically, it allows you to create users in your Kibana and manage what kind of roles or what kind of access those users will have. A console to run Elasticsearch expressions. Basically, it allows you to run queries. Like, for example, if you wanted to access something through in Elasticsearch, you can use queries to do so. Play with time series data using timeline. Basically, it allows you to study your timeline and apply time series functionalities to see basic trends or here and there. Monitor Elastic Stack using monitoring, which is basically monitor how well everything is doing in the end. So let's see which is the fourth tool. That is Beats. Beats is similar to Logstash in the matter of fact that they both collect the data that will be later stored and analyzed. But Beats differs in the method of collection. Here, Beats are multiple software installed on different servers from where they can collect the data and send it to Elasticsearch. Like I said earlier, Beats is not a single tool. It is a group of multiple tools which perform the same action as Logstash, except that they don't filter the data. But what they do is they attach themselves to the particular source and collect the data in real time and feed it back to Elasticsearch. They can either directly ship that data to Elasticsearch or they could send it to Logstash, where the collected data will be filtered by using Logstash's filtering ability. Now, if you look at the different beats we have, they are file beat, which is used to collect information on logs or log file. Then we have metric beat, which gathers metrics like RAM, CPU usage, input, output, application runtime to check if the app is running or not. Then we have packet beat. Packet beat is used for checking networking, analysis on networking data. It helps in figuring out discrepancies in data that may be being trafficked on the network, the actual data that being sent and received. It helps in making sure no one else is maybe using the network and stealing any of the sensitive information that is being trafficked over the network. Then we have audit beat, which is used for collecting audit events. Basically, audit messages contain details like if there was an unauthorized access to the system, it will record it based on the criteria that is set by the organization. Anytime you're accessing the admin or anytime you're accessing the user, then those kind of data will be stored in audit logs and audit beat will collect all those logs. Then we have winlog beat. It's exactly like how audit beat works. Only difference being it works on Windows based systems. It keeps track of events like hardware, security and applications on Windows systems. And then we have heartbeat. It's for uptime. Whether you are alive or not, it will record ping statistics. It will see if the remote server is reachable or not. That's its only job, to see whether there are any keep alives being pinged from one server to another and will record all those.
Quick note here guys, if you want to learn more about DevOps or become a certified DevOps engineer, IntelliPath does provide a DevOps certification course which is taught by certified industry professionals who will teach you many different DevOps tools. And if you want to know more about it, there are links in the description below.
Elk Flow. Now let us see step by step how the data flows from one software tool to another inside Elk. First, the beats are attached to remote servers from where the beats collect information from various sources. After collecting all the data needed, they either ship the data to Logstash for filtration or directly send the data to Elasticsearch. The data is then stored in Elasticsearch. From here, it will not be directly sent to Kibana. Kibana first needs to check where Elasticsearch is and then go and get the data itself so that it can later use it for any visualizations. If you see here, the data is first collected from the servers onto the beats, and then the beats take all the collected data and then ship it to Logstash or directly to Elasticsearch. After they ship it, Logstash will take the data, it will process it, and then it will filter it. And after it's done doing that, it will send the data ahead to Elasticsearch, where the data will be stored and indexed. And then finally, Kibana will take all the data from Elastic and it will analyze it and create visualizations based on the data. And suppose if there are any errors in the whole process, then notifications will be sent to whoever's responsible, using either Slack or whatever email notifier you have attached to it or configured to it. Features of Elk. System performance monitoring. So basically, it captures all the CPU usage, memory usage, input outputs, network performance, load averages, and etc. It has something called log management also, which basically means that it acts as a centralized logging storage. Now, every time a software works, it stores some kind of log data. Basically, all the metadata, like what kind of access was made to it, what kind of dependencies did it download, where was it accessed from, what was it accessed using, things like those will be stored in some log files. And Elk can manage those log files and can act as a logging manager. Application performance monitoring. Now, we can install an application performance management agent and integrate with Elk. So basically, what would happen is if you wanted to monitor the performance of your application, how much memory it's using or how many requests it has or something like that, then you can use a third-party tool for application performance monitoring. Now, Elastic itself provides its own APM, that is Application Performance Monitoring Manager, that itself is developed, but it is not open source. It can also be integrated with your Slack or email so that it will be able to send you emails or notify you anytime something goes wrong. Application data analysis. It's pretty self-explanatory. What it means is that it analyzes all the data you have collected, and based on that, it creates predictions or analysis. Security monitoring and alerting. Basically, if there are ever any security issues in your application or your service or your pipeline, it will inform you about it. And the last one, data visualization. As we talked a lot about, Kibana is used for this particular feature where all the data collected will be visualized in a meaningful manner so that we can understand how much or how well something is performing. Guys, now that we have understood what Elk is or Elastic Stack is, and now that we have understood what are the components of Elk like Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana or Beats, we can go ahead with its installation. Now let's go ahead and look at what are the prerequisites for it. So the prerequisites are, have at least 2 GB of RAM and have at least 20 GB of storage. And third, Java. So let's go ahead and configure all of these into our AWS instance. So we'll come to our AWS website and go into the AWS console and launch the EC2 dashboard. Now let's go ahead and click on launch instance. Now in this case, we will not be using CentOS 7 from AWS Marketplace. We will go ahead and use our Ubuntu server that is inside our free tier eligible quick start itself. Just scroll down, click on Ubuntu server 18.04, click on t2.medium since that's the one we'll be using. Click on configure next, add storage. We'll need at least 20 gigs of RAM, 20 gigs of space. Configure the security group, we'll make it all traffic. Review and launch. Launch, choose existing key pair, acknowledge and launch instances. Go ahead and view your instances and give it a name. I'll give it Elk. While it's being initialized, I'm gonna go ahead and launch my Booty tool and paste my IP address, increase the font size, change the color, green.
connection, keep some seconds alive so it doesn't switch off. Authorization, use the key, and now we'll wait for it to get initialized. Now that's running, we can go ahead and click on open. Click on yes and log in as Ubuntu, since we're using Ubuntu instance. We have started our instance. We have configured it as with at least 4 GB of RAM and 20 GB of space. Now let's go ahead and install Java. So let's look at the step for that. First command we'll be using is sudo apt-get update. So we'll update it before getting Java. Let's update it. Sudo apt-get update. Okay, now that we have updated our instance, let's go ahead and install Java. So for that, the command is sudo apt-get install minus y openjdk 8jdk. So let's clear the screen. Sudo apt-get install minus y open jdk 8 jdk and press enter. This will install Java for us, and since Java is a dependency for using one of the ELK tools, it will help us install the other tools. Now that we've installed Java, let's look at the next step. Next step, we'll be installing Nginx on the instance. So for that, we will first update it that we've already done. And then we'll use the command sudo apt-get minus y install Nginx. And then we'll enable. Come back to our instance, type in the command sudo apt-get install minus y Nginx. Now we are installing Nginx because we'll be using this as a web server to access our Kibana, since Kibana cannot be accessed from the outside. So we'll be using Nginx to access the Kibana from our current host, our user host, instead of our instance. So now we have installed our Nginx. Let's go ahead and enable it. Sudo systemctl enable Nginx. We've enabled it. Now let's look at the next step. That is downloading and installing Elasticsearch. So we'll be installing our Elasticsearch. So for that, the command we'll be using is wget and this link address. Paste it. And this is where our Elasticsearch is there. You can go and get this directly also from the website, but I'm just gonna go ahead and paste this and press enter. Before that, I'm gonna use sudo. Press enter. Then we'll use the command sudo dpkg minus I Elasticsearch, and this will install our Elasticsearch, this command. Okay, now that we've downloaded the package for Elasticsearch, let's go ahead and install it. Sudo dpkg minus I Elasticsearch, the version of it, an AMD64.DGB. Now press enter. Okay, now that we've downloaded our package Elasticsearch and installed it, we can go ahead and do the same thing with Kibana and Logstash. So the command for that is, first we'll get the package sudo wget, and this is the link of Kibana. You can get this from the website again in the same place. We'll download the package and then we'll download it and then we'll install it using the dpkg command. Sudo dpkg minus I is for the install, Kibana, and the name of the package we've installed. Let's go ahead and do the same thing for Logstash. Wait, before Logstash, we'll need to download one more dependency before we can install a Logstash. For installing that dependency is, the command is sudo apt-get install minus y apt-transport https. Press enter. Now we installed another dependency also, we can go ahead and install Logstash. So let's go ahead and get the link for Logstash. That is, this is the link. Let's copy it. Again, you can get it from the website. Sudo wget and the link of Logstash package. We'll download the package and then we'll install it using the dpkg minus I command. Now that we have installed our Elasticsearch, we have installed Kibana, Logstash, we can go ahead and install our file beat. Now, as I told you earlier, Beats is one of the tools, and Beats itself consists of multiple tools inside. So the one we'll be using today is FileBeat inside Beats. So let's go ahead and install our FileBeat. So let's look at the command for that. It's going to be the same thing as our previous ones. We'll be using wget to get the link of FileBeat, and we're using dpkg to get the to install the package. Now for the last one, I'll show you how to get it from the website itself. We'll go back to our browser, open another tab. In the browser, we will type Elastic, that is the name of the company, and FileBeat, and we'll be using the 7.2 version. Now, since that is the version we need, all the other versions of the tools we downloaded was 7.2, if you notice. So this is the one we'll be downloading, even though the latest version may be something else. Now, I'm doing this only because of consistency, but you can go ahead and install the latest version if you wish to. This is the version I'll be selecting. This is the click on the first link, and then use the DEB 64-bit version. So right click on it, copy the link address, come back to your instance, use the command sudo wget to get the link, paste the link address and press enter. This will download a package for us. As you can see, the package is downloaded now. Now we will go ahead and install FileBeat. So we will use the command sudo dpkg-i for install, and the name of the package FileBeat, and go ahead and click enter. This will install our FileBeat. Okay guys, we have installed all of our packages that we needed. We installed first Elasticsearch, then second Kibana, then third Logstash, then fourth FileBeat. Now we have all of these, we can go ahead with the practice. Now let's look at what are the steps we'll be taking during our hands-on or practice.
Quick note here guys, if you want to learn more about DevOps or become a certified DevOps engineer, IntelliPath does provide a DevOps certification course which is taught by certified industry professionals who will teach you many different DevOps tools. And if you want to know more about it, there are links in the description below.
Elk hands-on. So let's look at what are the steps we'll be taking. First, collecting static Apache logs using Logstash and analyzing them using Kibana. Second, collecting static .csv files using Logstash and analyzing them using Kibana. And the third, collecting and configuring real-time web logs and injecting them into Elasticsearch and analyzing them using Kibana. So what's happening here is that in the first two steps, we'll be analyzing two different types of static data, where the data is static, where we already have the sample data and we're not collecting it real-time from one source. And in the third step, we'll be collecting the data from a real source, and we'll be doing it in real time. We'll be feeding the data continuously from our source into our Elasticsearch, and then we'll be using Kibana to analyze it. Suppose if we saw any changes, so if suppose there were any changes in the data that was being collected, we'll be able to see that on Kibana. Let's go ahead and do all of these steps. We'll come back to our instance. Okay guys, before moving on towards the steps, we'll go ahead and configure our Elasticsearch and Kibana. So let's go ahead and configure our Elasticsearch. For that, we will need to go inside etc Elasticsearch and Elasticsearch dot, let's use the nano editing tool. And once you go inside this .yaml file, you can see that all the configurations can be made inside this. So the configuration we need to make is, we just need to take out the comments. We need to make sure cluster name is not a comment. We need to make sure that node.name is not a comment. And we need to make sure that the network host is not a comment. And inside the network host, replace whatever IP address is there with local host. And come down, and the HTTP port, leave it at 9200. The four things we have to configure inside the Elasticsearch.yaml file is, we have to set the network host as localhost, and you have to uncomment HTTP port, and you have to uncomment the cluster name and the node name. After you're done with that, go ahead and press Ctrl O, press Enter, and Ctrl X. Now we have made changes to our Elasticsearch.yaml. So we can go ahead and start it. Sudo systemctl start elasticsearch. If we check out the status, it says that it's active and running. Great. So let's go ahead and do the same thing with Kibana. We'll type in sudo nano slash etc slash Kibana slash Kibana dot YAML file. Now let's go inside this. And the two things we have to uncomment are the server port. We'll leave it at 5601. And the second thing we have to configure is we have to remove the comment over here and make sure that server.host is localhost. After you uncomment server port and server host, just go ahead and save it and exit out of that. Now we have configured our Kibana and we have configured our Elasticsearch. Okay, let's go ahead and start our Kibana. For that, the command is sudo systemctl start Kibana. Let's check out the status. It's active and running. Great. Clear the screen. Guys, now let's go ahead and configure Kibana so it can have a username and password when we access it using Nginx. So for that, we would need to use something called htpassword. Now, htpassword is a part of Apache 2 utils. So we need to install that. So we'll go ahead and type sudo apt get install minus y Apache 2 utils. Now that we've installed that, we can go ahead and use that command. So the command is htpassword. This will help us generate a hashed password for our user. ht, let's add sudo before this, sudo htpassword minus c space etc slash nginx slash htpassword.users. This is where we'll store all the user and passwords. And let's go ahead and type the username now. So the username we'll be using is kib admin, keep admin. Press enter, it will prompt you for a password. Enter a simple password since we are just practicing. It will say that adding password for the user kib admin. Now if you want to see if a password is added or not, we can go ahead and check it inside. Sudo nano, let's go ahead and take this and paste it and press enter. We can see that inside the full file, we have kib admin and the hashed password. Let's go ahead and save it and exit. Now that we have a password, we can go ahead and configure our Nginx default file where we will connect our Nginx to our Kibana. For that, we will type in sudo nano slash etc slash Nginx slash sites available and default. Inside this file, we'll be storing the code which will configure our Nginx to be connected to Kibana. So the code will be, this is the code we'll be using. Server listen at 80, server name, instance private IP. Let's go ahead and write that. It's basically going to be the IP address of the instance we launched using AWS. So to get this, we'll have to go to the browser. Let's go to the browser, come to our AWS console, copy the IP address of the instance we launched, come back, paste it. Great. Now that we have configured it to connect to our instance also, make sure that the basic user file is going to be the place where you store the username and the password for Kibana. And the proxy pass you use at the port, localhost port 5601. When we access this IP address at the port 80, it will indirectly connect us to localhost at port 5601, where we have our Kibana. So we can access a Kibana indirectly using Nginx anywhere from outside. So let's go ahead and save this. Control O, Enter, Control X. Now that we have configured our Nginx, we can go ahead and start Nginx. Sudo systemctl start Nginx. Now let's go ahead and check out the status. It is active and running. Let's go to our browser and launch it. So we'll copy the IP address, paste it, and press enter. Now it will ask us the username and password. The username and password we used were kib admin and password would be the one you entered. As you can see now that your Kibana has started. We'll just explore on our own. That was the step to start Kibana by connecting it to Nginx. What we did was we created a password and username using htpassword. This is the command sudo htpassword -c etc nginx htpassword.users kiba-admin. So we use this to create a username, and as it will prompt us the password, we enter the password and we stored it inside this file htpassword. And when we were configuring Nginx inside the default file, we mentioned the path to this for authorization. That's why when we access this, it gave us the prompt to ask our username and password. And it also connected the Kibana to internet. Normally, Kibana would not be able to be accessed by anyone from outside. We could only have access it from the instance. But we want everyone else also to access it. So we connected it to Nginx, which acted as a web server, which connected to the Kibana on the port 5601 and made it available on the port 80. Clear? Using Kibana, we'll be creating some customized dashboards and visualizations. So let's go ahead and ingest some static data so that we can visualize it. Come back to our instance. So to start the whole process, our first step, we would first need to download a static sample data set. To do that, we will use the wget command and we will get a sample data set. So let me tell you what the link would be. The link would be https://logs.io/sample-data-o. This is the thing we'd be needing. Sudo wget https://logs.io/sample-data. So this will download some Apache logs. These are just sample logs which somebody posted online and we're just downloading them for our practice. One second. It's logs with a Z. Now if we ls, we have our sample data. Now let's name it much more appropriately. Let's go and use the command sudo cp to copy the sample data file and we will push it into apache.log. More appropriately named now. So if we ls it, we'll see the Apache log is here. Now if we cat the apache.log file, we can see all the data has been stored. This is the sample data we downloaded. Now let's go ahead and inject this so that we can visualize it using Kibana. For that, we would first need to go inside logstash. We will go inside cd etc logstash. Now you would have noticed most of the packages we download and install are inside etc. Mostly they'll be inside etc only. etc logstash and inside conf.t. Now inside this we will have a file apache.apache-log.conf. We'll open it up. And this is a new file, and inside this file, we'll create a pipeline. Normally, maybe the users or the support engineers or the middleware engineers would tell us how the data will be injected in Elasticsearch. For that, we would need to write a pipeline. A pipeline mainly consists of three things. Input, that is the source of data, filter, what kind of data is not to be sent, and output, where do we have to send the data to. Let's go ahead and write our pipeline inside the logstash. We come back to our notepad. This is the code we'll need. Let's get out of here. Use nano. Alright, let's go ahead and paste the code. We use nano because nano is a bit better editor. Gives us a little bit more options to work with. As you can see, as I said, this is the pipeline. Normally you would code it, but I've already written it. I'm just going to go ahead and paste it. And I've pasted it here. Now in the path, you would mention where the file is located. Your sample data set is located. Right now, my sample data set is located inside home Ubuntu in apache.log. We'll go ahead and make sure this is correct after we go through the whole code. This is where the log will be located. And the second thing we'll be configuring is starting position. That is the beginning. If you want, you can change it to middle or end. And since we don't have any database directly where we can extract the data, we're not going to put anything. We're just going to leave it null. And this is the filter. And grok. Grok is a filter. Here, the timestamp and the GeoIP, the date, and these are the ones that are going to be filtered using these keywords, okay? And in the end, the last thing, that is the output. That output will be stored inside our Elasticsearch. The host at localhost at the port 9200. And this index is important. Right now, whenever you would go to your Kibana, you would first have to create a new index. You would have to create a new index. Only then can you access the data. For that, we are writing over here, example, pet clinic PRD1. We will be easily able to identify what our data is stored as inside the Elasticsearch. Right now, our data is only stored inside our system. Now, and we are going to be outputting it to Elasticsearch. So we will index it under the title pet clinic PRD1. Now I'll explain to you why I've written one over there. You know, bit. So let's go ahead and save this, press enter and come out. Now that we configured our apache-log.conf, we can go ahead and start our log stash. Use the command sudo systemctl space start log stash. Now we can go ahead and check the status of our log stash. Okay, it says it's active and running. Now let's go to our browser. We can check where our data is. We can access the data in the Elastic stash. Right now, what must have happened? Logstash must have taken the data from our instance and sent it to the Elasticsearch, where Elasticsearch would have indexed it under the title we had given it. So if we go to our browser, now that we're inside our browser, we'll go to the first icon over here called Discover. Inside Discover, our first job would be to create an index pattern. You would go under Kibana, click on Index Patterns, and there'll be an option here to click on Create Index Pattern. We will go ahead and type the index name here. Remember what index name we had given before? That was pet clinic. If we type pet clinic over here, we should be able to get a yes. As you can see, we were able to find our sample data that we had stored in our Elasticsearch. Now we have pet clinic. The thing is, why we typed to one over here is because sometimes we might have multiple different logs or multiple different sets of data. If you want to select all of those data, if I had like a pet clinic PRD 2, 3, 4, 5, and I want to select all of them, I could go ahead and use this star, pet star. But if I only wanted only one of them, I could go ahead and type pet clinic PRD and 1. This would only select one of these. But if I had multiple of them and I want to select all of them, I could go ahead and use my star. Next step. And we'll use the timestamp for this is for configuring settings. Go ahead and create an index pattern. To visualize and explore data in Kibana, you must create an index pattern. An index pattern tells Kibana which Elasticsearch indices contain the data you want to work with. An index pattern can match a single index, multiple indices, and a roll-up index. The one we selected was single index. Just because we added data to logstash, it doesn't mean the data will show up. That's why we needed to create our index pattern to see which data would be indexed. Basically, it's like categorizing the data that you receive. And that's how we did it. We wrote pet clinic PRD 1 star. We got our index over here. Our index pattern can match multiple Elasticsearch indices, but we only had one. It only worked with this one. Now we can see that these are all the keywords over here. If you wanted to check our, if we click on discover, you'll see that we can go through our data, whatever data we have stored in Elasticsearch. And you can use many things over here. First thing we'll see is filter. We can go ahead and write something. So I'm gonna go ahead and type one of the keywords, GeoIP city name dot keyword. And I want to search for particular city, so I want to search for Taipei. So if I click on Taipei, and I'll click on update. It will give me only the data for Taipei, with the keyword, with filtered keyword Taipei. So it will only give me all the data that was accessed through Taipei and give me a graph also. Now you can go ahead and use KQL, that is Kibana Query Language. It offers a simplified query syntax and support for scripted fields. It's like basic queries in simple language. Now if we go to our search and type A, we find agent.keyword. These, whatever keywords we type, right? Like we typed A and we found agent.keyword. We can, whatever fields we type are generated based on whatever data we have. These keywords are always related to the data and they can be filtered if you want them to be filtered. If you click on agent.keyword and click on Mozilla, it will show us all the Mozilla Firefox accessed requests. And one more thing we could do is you can go ahead and change the time. You click on the calendar icon over here. You can change whenever you want. It'll give you one hour detail. But since this is static data, it doesn't really matter over here. If you go last 1 year, it will show you the data for a whole year. And all of this happens in real time. And if you want to add a filter, since we have created this filter, we can go ahead and add this. Or we can add a filter. You want to add timestamp or you want to add index, whatever. So you can go ahead and add your filters over here. Okay guys, now that we've learned how to upload Apache logs or logs in general and present it on Kibana, we can go ahead and learn how to do the same for .csv files. That was our second step.
Quick note here guys, if you want to learn more about DevOps or become a certified DevOps engineer, IntelliPath does provide a DevOps certification course which is taught by certified industry professionals who will teach you many different DevOps tools. And if you want to know more about it, there are links in the description below.
Collecting static.csv using Logstash and analyzing them using Kibana. So we are done with Apache logs. Let's go and do it with .csv files. Okay. So if we come back to our instance, let's go back to the cd. We'll be using the command called curl. Okay. So sudo curl minus o minus capital O, and this is the link. We will be getting the CSV file for CrimeSynth done in 2001, and this was collected by the FBI. If we go ahead and enter this, it will start downloading the .csv file for us. And if we get this, we can see that we have the crimes2001.csv. And if I cat, as you can see, it has all the crime details, the date it was done, the time, the place, what kind of crime it was, etc, etc. Now let's go ahead and create another pipeline. Whenever we need to use Logstash and upload data using it to our Elasticsearch, we need to create a pipeline and we need to fill three kinds of data. That is, while we're creating the pipeline, that is input, our filter and output. So let's go ahead and do that. So we will head to our Logstash folder. Inside our Logstash, we would go inside con and enter. As you can see, our Apache log.conf is already here. We're going to go ahead and create another .conf file called sudo nano crimes.conf. Inside this, we're going to write our pipeline for uploading our data, the .csv data, and uploading it to Elasticsearch. Okay, so for that, the commands are, this is the script we'll be using. So like I said before, we need to use input, a filter and output. So these are the three important things when you are developing a pipeline for your Logstash. Now if you go through this, we see that the input is over home Ubuntu crime2001.csv. This is where we are taking our .csv file from, and because this is our input, and filter will be telling us how to filter it. In this, what I've done is I've written the way how to separate the data. Inside columns, you can see ID, case number, data, date, block, IUCR, primary type, description. So when the Elasticsearch reads through it, it will see how to separate it, and it will separate it based on whatever details I've given. You will use the separator in comma. And the output, where I'll be sending it to? I'll be sending it to Elasticsearch. My host will be the localhost, that is the instance, and index will be crimes. This is important because when we are using Kibana to create a index pattern, This will help us identify whichever data we are uploaded. Let's go ahead and save it. Control O, Control X. So let's go ahead and start system CDL start logstash. Now if we go and check the status of logstash, you can see that it's run. Now if we go back to our browser and inside here, we will scroll down and go to management, click on index patterns under Kibana. And this is our previous one. Click on create index pattern. Now we will wait for the crimes data to appear over here so we can include it. If I type it right now, it won't show because it will take a little bit of time. If it still doesn't show over here, then you can go back to your instance and go ahead and restart your logstash. This usually works in uploading the data. So if I go ahead and click on refresh, now if you wait a bit, you can see that your data has been uploaded. Since it's a lot of data, it was about 11 MB of data, it might take a little bit more time. It depends on how big your data is and it might take some time to upload if the data is too big. So I'm going to go ahead and type lines over here and we'll match it and click on next step. We'll configure the settings, we'll use timestamp and create the index pattern. Our crimes index pattern has been created. Now we can do whatever we want with this using Kibana. If we go down, you can see there's arrest, arrest keyword, beat, block, and etc. So if we go back to our discover, we remove all this. You can toggle between whichever data you want to over here. You can click on crimes. If we go down, you can see all the data over here. And these are the filters, available filter. If I want to add the arrest filter, I go ahead and add the arrest filter. It will show which arrests are false or true, etc. based on the keyword I've chosen. And if you click on it, you can see all the data that has been classified. You can also check the JSON format if you want to. And since it's written in both, it's written in JSON, but you can view it in table form or JSON also. Okay guys, now we have learned how to upload .csv files and present it on Kibana. Let's go ahead and do the third step. Our third step was collecting and configuring real-time web logs and injecting them into Elasticsearch and analyzing them using Kibana. Let's come back to our instance, clear the screen and get out of this folder. We are in our home Ubuntu folder. Now we are gonna go ahead and use our file beats. Now remember, using Filebeats in this case instead of Logstash is because Filebeats is a little bit easier to use and it's a little bit more automated. And now we'll be using Filebeats for our real-time data. We had seen how it would happen for static data. Now let's go ahead and see how it will work for real-time data. For that, we will be using components in our own system. Instead of getting sampled static data, we're going to be using actual working components inside our system. What kind of data can we collect here? Well, we know that our system is running and our system itself will be generating logs about how it's working and how it's not working. And we can gather data from Nginx. Since we are using Nginx to run our Kibana, we can see what all details Nginx is producing in its log and metadata. Let's go ahead and enable all of those configurations in our Filebeat. Unlike for Logstash, in Filebeat or normal beats, you do not have to write a pipeline. So it's a little bit more easier. So let's go ahead and type this command sudo Filebeat modules list. This will show us two things. First, it will show us enabled and it will show us disabled. So what it's showing us here is that there are components that are disabled here and there are components that are enabled. Since there's nothing enabled, that means Filebeat is not working right now. Let's go ahead and enable our Nginx and our system. So for that, the commands will be sudo Filebeat enable modules Nginx. Sudo Filebeat modules enable Nginx. It will tell us that Nginx has been enabled. Now let's do the same thing with system. And you can see that it enables system also. If we type the command sudo filebeat modules list We can see that under enable, we have Nginx and system also now. Now we can see that FileBeat will be starting up and will be starting to collect the data from Nginx and system. So let's go ahead and configure these so that it knows where to collect the data properly from and from what all data to collect from these things. To configure those details, we will go inside cd etc FileBeat inside modules.d, and inside modules.d you can see there are a lot of YAML files for each enabled or disabled modules. Since we have enabled nginx.yaml, we do not see a dot disabled over here. So let's go ahead and open it up. Sudo nano nginx.yaml. As you can see, it shows enabled over here. Inside our nginx.yaml file, you can see that it says enabled for the access for nginx and error logs also. Let's go ahead and tell us where the logs are. Even though we have enabled it, we haven't told where the location for the logs will be. We can go ahead and write those. So for that, we'll be writing var:paths:(brackets)). And inside the double quotes, we'll write the location of the logs. The location is /var/log/engine(x/access.log). And star. The star is so that there might be multiple access logs and we want all of them. This will get us all the access logs. And if we come down, let's go ahead and enable for the error logs also. Now every software can have some kind of error and those errors will be stored in some log file. So let's go ahead and configure that also over here. Copy this. Something's the same. Instead of access log, we'll write error.log and star. Let's go ahead and save this. These are the only two things we'll be configuring here. Now we have configured it for nginx.yaml. Let's go ahead and do the same thing for system.yaml. Since we'll be collecting two data sets in real time from nginx and from system.yaml. And we'll do the same thing over here for system. We'll give it the path to where to get the things from. So the address is a little bit different here. The address is var/log/syslog*. Same thing over here. Now, in case of system, there are little different logs. There's the systems logs and there's the authorization log. This log will keep track of who all have accessed the system or not. Now we have given the path address. We can go ahead and save this, control okay, and then it'll come out. Now that we've configured our FileBeat to have Nginx and systems enabled as modules, and now we have configured the path to where the logs are, we can go ahead and start our FileBeat. So we will type sudo systemctl /start/filebeat. Let's go ahead and check the status. We press enter. We can see that it's active and running. Great. Now to wait for a bit of time until the data is loaded onto our Kibana. Let's go ahead. We have to do the same thing again. We have to create an index pattern inside our Kibana. Go to management under Kibana, we'll click on index patterns. We'll wait for the data to be created. As we can see, the data has been uploaded to Elasticsearch and Kibana can identify it. So if you type over here FileBeat, it will automatically identify it. And click on next step using timestamp to configure it and create the index pattern. And if you went to discover, you go ahead and click on FileBeat, and you can go through all the filters you want, like cloud machine type or whatever, etc. Okay guys, now we learned how to upload and present the data on Kibana. Let's go ahead and try how to visualize all of them. We will start the visualization with Petclinic Crimes and then we'll do FileBeat, okay, one by one. So first, go ahead to visualize, click on create new visualization. It will ask us which kind of visualization we want. We will go ahead and choose area and we will choose it for our first one, PetClinic BID1. and it will give us a lot of details to configure, like y-axis and x-axis. Let's click on x-axis and let's make sure the aggregation is count. No need for custom label. Now we've done y-axis, make sure the aggregation is count. And you come down, click on x-axis. We can go ahead and choose another kind of aggregation, whatever other than count, we can go ahead count against maybe, let's go terms. And inside field, we can choose any of the keywords. I would go ahead and type response keyword and order by metric count, or we can put this as HTTP request, since that's what these are. These are requests. By count meaning how many people have accessed it. And our metric will be by HTTP request. And since this is a sample data set, that's why it's such a large detail over here. Otherwise, if we were using something that was just recently started, you wouldn't see such a large count. And order descending, size 5. Now you can go ahead and click on this play button over here, apply changes. And you can see a graph over here. Now under, you can go ahead and choose whichever field and aggregation you want for whichever axis over here and customize it all according to your need. Now you can change the field you want over here. We put response over here, but you can click on geolocation, latitude, longitude and click on apply changes. It will show you all the changes over here. And if you want to directly change metrics, go under metrics and axes, and here you can easily change chart type. You can make it line chart, or you can make it bar chart, and etc. Now once the type of visualization you need has been created, you can go ahead and save your visualization. So if you want to view this kind of visualization later, you might, and you do not wish to enter all these configuration details again, you can just save this kind of visualization. So you can use it later. So I'm gonna save this one as Apache total. What detail do we select? Geolocation. So I'm gonna save it as Apache geolocations based on latitude. And confirm my save. If I go back to my visualization, visualize over here, it will show me a saved visualization. Suppose you had different kinds of visualizations you wanted to check, you can come under visualization and check them. You can search them up also. So if I click on my geolocation based on latitude, it will directly show me the visualization that I created earlier. Now that we've done it for how to do it for a bar graph and we used for our pet clinic, let's go ahead and try another visualization. Come back to our visualizations, create a new visualization, and now we will learn how to do a heat map. We will use crimes for this. So it will, heat maps will show us wherever there is high density of whatever metric you're using. Suppose there's a high count of something in one specific field, it will show it more darker than a place where there is a less concentration of the count or a field. Let's go ahead and try that. We will click under metrics value and we'll leave the aggregation as count and we'll give it a custom label called FBI code. And if we come under x-axis, we'll give it aggregation of terms and select a field. We will select FBI code.keyword. We'll leave it as such and go ahead and click on play, apply changes. And as you can see, this is the heat map. It is showing us the legend over here, like which color represents what. So as we saw, as we talked about, darker the color is, the higher the density of the hits or count would be. And as we lower, we can see that the number reduces. Here the API code is 10,000, it reduces 8, and then 5,000, and 5,000, and 4,000, etc. And if you wanted to change how this looks, you can come under options. And you can change it from left to right and then green to reds or yellow to red. If you click on this, you can see this is changed over here. I like mine right. If I apply the changes, it will show us a clean visualization over here from red to yellow. Now if you want to see this in more detail, you can go ahead and increase the number of colors, make it 10 and then apply the changes and you can see the changes over here. These are the colors we adjusted over here. We've learned how to create two kinds of visualizations, that is heat map and area. So if you want to try any other kind of visualizations, you can go ahead and select whichever one you want. You can go on coordinate map, it will show you a world map and it will point out positions based on your field you're choosing. Suppose you had number of requests to your component, to your software, and you wanted to see where all these requests are coming from, and you wanted to see where the most number of requests coming from, you can use a coordinate map to check all those. I can create a data table, a horizontal bar, line, etc. Now we learn how to create visualizations. Let's go ahead and try how to create dashboards. Dashboards is just under visualize. You click on dashboard and you go ahead and create a new dashboard. Okay, this dashboard is empty, but we can add more dashboards over here. So if you wanted to add any of the visualizations you had created, you can go ahead and click on add, and it will show you which all visualizations you have created. I want to add this visualization and I want to add this visualization. You have two visualizations over here. This is basically how you would create your dashboard, add all visualizations whichever you want, or you can have custom made dashboards that have already been created that you can use. If you want to save this dashboard that you have created by yourself, you can go ahead and click on save dashboard, give it a good name, practice or whatever is relevant, and go ahead and click on confirm save. If you come back to your dashboards, you can see that your preferred dashboard or your saved dashboard is here. If you click on the dashboard, you can see all the visualizations that you created. If we come back to our dashboards, we have learned how to create visualizations and how to create dashboards. That's great and all, but our main objective over here is to create a real-time dashboard. What we used was sample data. Now we do know how to upload real-time statistics over here in file B, using file B, but we want to create a dashboard which will represent all the details that have been fed in using the file B. There's a special command for that which will give us a default set of dashboards that have already been created. Like Elastic was like, they want to give us a default set of dashboards so that we don't have to create it. Or if you want to check out sample data, you can use those default dashboards. To set those dashboards up, you go back to your instance, and here you would type the command sudo file b setup and minus e. It will first verify the connections with your Kibana and Elasticsearch, whether they are proper or not, and then it will set up default dashboards. If you type enter, if you press enter, you can see that it is loading dashboards for Kibana must be running and reachable. So whenever you are typing in this command, make sure your Kibana is running and then you type the command. Now we had to wait for some time before it loads all the dashboards. And after it's done loading those dashboards, we can use these already made dashboards. Now to see whether these dashboards have been created or not, we'll go back to our browser. Now that we come to our browser and under the dashboard, we can see that there are many dashboards over here that have been already been created, which helps us save time because these are already created dashboards for specific purposes and we do not need to create them from scratch. The one we'll be using for our Nginx is our file beat. If you go to your search and type file beat and type Nginx, as you can see, there are already been created dashboards for Nginx module for FileBeat. So if you click on this one and you click on this one, it will show us a lot of details over here. It shows us the coordinate map over here, the access map, wherever accesses you have done from. Suppose the most accesses you have been done from this area, this part of the world. And it will show us things like respond code over time, errors over time, top pages, and data volume, and the browser breakdown from wherever, which all browsers you have accessed it from. Since this is something we created using Nginx and Kibana, this is basically showing us all the details that the Nginx we are using for running our Kibana. So since you run this Kibana using Google Chrome, it will show us that only one browser has been used, that is Chrome. So if you wanted to see a real-time change being made over here, we'll do one thing. You can take this IP address and use another browser, since all this data is being fed in real time. So if I opened up my Firefox, and if I paste my IP address over here, it will ask for the username and password. I keep admin. Press enter. Don't say. If you load the Kibana. So basically what we're doing is we're accessing the link over here for the instance using Nginx. So if we come back to our Google Chrome and inside this browser, we refresh, we will see a new change over in the browser selection. You can see there's something for Firefox now. This means that someone using Firefox has accessed our Nginx port, that is for Kibana, the IP address. This is for our real-time data, how to upload and present our real-time data. And you can use already set up dashboard instead of creating your own. It actually depends on you and your company, what kind of company is working in, what kind of details they were needing, what kind of things they would be configuring, and etc. It totally depends on the requirements of your application and requirements of your company. Guys, today we learned a lot of things. First, we understood what Elk is. Then we saw what are the components of Elk, like Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana, Filebeats. Then we learned how Logstash and Filebeats are similar. Then we saw the flow of how the information flows inside Elk. Then one more thing we saw was we saw how to upload this data using Filebeats or Logstash onto Elasticsearch. And then we opened up our Kibana and then accessed that data using our Kibana and then made visualizations and we made real-time visualization like we did right now.
Quick note here, guys, if you want to learn more about DevOps or become a certified DevOps engineer, IntelliPath does provide a DevOps certification course, which is taught by certified industry professionals who will teach you many different DevOps tools. And if you want to know more about it, there are links in the description below. Okay guys, this brings us to the end of the video. If you have any queries about what was taught, then leave a comment below and we will get back to you at the earliest. Thank you for watching.